In September of 1859, a solar geomagnetic storm occurred, known as the Carrington Event, that wreaked absolute havoc on the technology available in those days, specifically telegraph stations that reported sparking and even a fire due to geomagnetically induced current. This led to a curious effect. Even when the telegraph operators turned their equipment off, they were still able to send and receive messages. That phenomenon was specific to how telegraph systems worked, but it's a bit spooky to contemplate a piece of technology staying on even after unplugging it, just pulling energy from the environment. This event also caused massive and widespread auroras, and was most likely caused by a coronal mass ejection from the sun. Indeed, there was an observed solar flare that may have been directly related to it. If this were to happen today, and it very well might, and we had a coronal mass ejection pointed directly at us, it would wreak havoc on our technology and have long-lasting effects, such as the power grid going down long-term. But the Carrington event, as bad as it was, doesn't seem to be the worst the sun can do. In the year 774 or 75, a spike in carbon-14 concentrations in tree rings is seen that are 20 times the normal background. More, this event seems to also be present in the form of beryllium isotopes and ice cores, correlating exactly to the same time period. This has variously been termed the Miyake or Charlemagne event, Miyake being the scientist who discovered it, and a reference to Charlemagne, who was reigning as king of the Franks at the time. Further evidence suggests that whatever it was global, and the creation of carbon-14 was almost instantaneous. So whatever caused this specific event happened very rapidly. The problem is, this event was over 100 times more powerful than the Carrington event, and it's not unique. There is evidence of another just 200 years later, and at least 4 other instances of very high energy radiation hitting Earth. These Miyake events are very puzzling because of their intense power. The prevailing current theory is that it's the sun, and it can produce solar flares of much greater power than we'd previously thought. But there's a problem. The sun functions on a solar cycle, with sunspots and flares reaching a maximum every 11 years. The Miyake events, however, seem to occur regardless of where the sun is in its cycle. More, they vary in duration. Some seem very short, yet others seem to last over a year, and one seems to have built up over the course of a decade. Whatever this phenomenon is, it's dangerous to technological civilization. Unpredictable, though they do average out in one event every 1,000 years, but only loosely, and come out of nowhere, and we're overdue for one. These are not normal solar flares. That's assuming that they are solar flares at all. There are other ways to make the observed isotopes, including cosmic rays, but alternative hypotheses include gamma ray bursts, nearby supernovae, and perhaps the strangest is bombardment from passing neutron stars. None of these explanations fit very well, however, and there's no recent evidence indicating any of that. There is some possibility that there's something we don't know or don't understand about isotope generation here on Earth. And it's also possible that all of these events were not due to the same cause, but the best bet so far is that somehow the sun can produce sustained and multiple flares occasionally in a collective superflare. Another strange aspect of this is that there's very little in the historical record about these events. Mostly people just went about their daily lives and saw nothing unusual, as solar flares of this nature do not pose a risk to life in general, just modern technology. There was, however, one report in the year 775 in England of a red cross appearing in the sky, something that sounds somewhat similar to an aurora. Also, Chinese astronomers recorded auroras in connection to this event. But a storm of that magnitude should have sparked off absolutely astounding aurora activity that no one could have missed. But other than those two mentions, it seems to have been a non-issue. But the biggest question of all is what would happen if these events were to hit today? To answer this first, we must visit the past. Imagine for a moment it was the year 1800 and you were looking for a video like this one. You'd have been the greatest visionary in human history if you could conceive that someday actual still pictures of humans would exist. Even though in 1800 there were people alive that would eventually be photographed. Indeed, there are some claims that the earliest born human ever photographed could have been born as early as 1737, though at the time they'd have been around 113 years old in 1851 when the daguerreotype was taken. Not impossible, but rather unlikely. That said, there are plenty of confirmed cases of people born in the 18th century being photographed. Here is Arthur Wellesley, the Duke of Wellington, who defeated Napoleon Bonaparte at the Battle of Waterloo, and would later become Prime Minister of the United Kingdom. He was born in 1769, here seen in a rather triumphant pose in a painting. Here he is photographed later in life. The point is, though, that few people born in the 18th century could have envisioned that their visage would be directly reproduced without a painter involved. No one in those days could have imagined that moving pictures would someday be possible, and no one would have envisioned that someday YouTuber science fiction authors would upload regular videos about space, existential crises, and interviews with scientific luminaries while adding in opossum content and saying the word live strangely. I was not foreseen, and something tells me that the Duke would not approve, but two can play at that game. But ask yourself, can you envision a world without photography? Another somewhat different situation is the much more recent development of going to the moon. In contrast, that was envisioned. Jules Verne, the films of Georges Méliès, and so on all depict humans going to the moon. This is because the Age of Enlightenment brought with it a scientific understanding of the moon, and it was, in principle, possible to go there and set foot on it. This was realized with the Apollo program starting in 1969, but still represented, as it does today, a gigantic technological leap. But herein lies a question. These advances made for us a life that is markedly different from our origins as natural Homo sapiens. We're still the same species as any human that's ever lived, but with a very different mentality and understanding of our surroundings when compared to our ancestors. Take my own ancestry. People often ask me why I have a name that looks like it should be on a Canadian hockey player's jersey, and I can emphatically say blame France via Quebec. Given my French Creole quasi-Cajun genetics, I often look with fascination at prehistoric French cave paintings, such as those at Chauvet Cave, and wonder however distantly I might be related to the person that painted that cave wall almost 37,000 years ago. Do I carry some remnant of their DNA? And the answer is, almost certainly yes. But what was their life like? How different is it really between painting an elk on a cave wall versus making a YouTube video? The reality is that when you look at cave paintings of animals, and with Chauvet, a single fertility symbol, you see what was important to them: food and successful reproduction, the cycle of human life. We still care about this, of course, but food is far easier to obtain today, and medical science has drastically cut child mortality. What was once a task of finding a mammoth and spearing it has largely been replaced in the developed world with a trip to the grocery store. Our modern paradigm truly is a world away from what our natural paradigm actually was. And this leads to a spooky question. What if our paradigm suddenly went away? Futurist James Burke once envisioned what this would be like. It would be beyond difficult to go from living in an apartment in the city to operating a farm with 19th century technology overnight. And once we addict ourselves to a technology, it becomes very difficult to go backwards. A good example here is the internet. I remember a time when it basically didn't exist in the public mind, and even when I graduated high school, it was still largely relegated to message boards and dial-up modems. Within 3 years of that, I was involved in making most of my living using the internet, and it's been that way ever since, to the present with my YouTube channels. Such was the internet revolution of the 1990s. But now, if the internet suddenly went away, it becomes, at least for me, jarring and unpleasant, since it's such an integral part of my life. A power outage for me is disconcerting and frustrating enough, but a permanent loss of that technology would at the very least force a reordering of everything I do, providing I survived it. A return to pre-industrial existence overnight due to some calamity, such as a solar flare, would wreak a level of havoc on our civilization to the point that it might be its end. It's possible that an enormous amount of people could be lost as a result, and civilization is unable to recover in a meaningful way. This gets worse as time goes on. We will eventually run out of fossil fuels and will become increasingly dependent on our technological paradigm, presumably by that time, fusion energy. Interrupt that with a solar flare, and you might not be able to make it back to where you were for lack of formerly important resources. It's back to horses and manual plows, or some hybridized new technological paradigm that incorporates many different past technologies that have left obsolescence. No matter any way you slice it, however, the answer is bad news. And while the idea of a solar flare hitting us in a Carrington-style event is scary, that there is an unknown, mystery, super flare situation still not fully understood by science is terrifying. Thanks for listening. I am futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently perplexed in that over the course of the last year, I wrote more spooky October scripts than I could possibly ever have produced as videos within a single month. So dear subscriber, let me spin a yarn of next month, after spooky October is finished. And we begin the November leftovers, which will actually contain some of the spookiest members of the group. Let's call it Spookvember. And as always, check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.